fundamental problem with education in this country, and what specifically would you do to address it? Malam Ribadu, would you like to start?
Thank you, Chinamanda, and it's a pleasure to be with you. The question is about education, but it's also about our own country. Things are not good with the country, and things are not good with education. We just have to do something, and that is the reason why I've come out and I'm contesting to have the chance for us to fix it. First and foremost, we have to invest in our education. We have to put more money. Today, we are putting just about 6% of our budget into it. We need to put more. We do intend to scale it up the first year up to 12%. And when we put in this money, we are going to be very specific. We are going to work on the infrastructure. We are going to work on bringing technology into our school system. We are going to address the problem of primary education. We are going to work on the teachers. We are going to make sure that the quality improves as we also address the quantity. Those two things must go together. But education is the foundation. It's the first thing if you want to change a society. Unfortunately, it's not been good for with us in the last, particularly 2 decades. That is why we are recording 98% failure. We will reverse it.
Sirs, do you think then that the fundamental problem is lack of funding?
It is mismanagement and lack of funding. It is not giving priority to education. It is like getting it wrong by those who are in charge of our own affairs. Instead of putting money where you could guarantee our future, they ended up putting it into their own pocket. Today in our country, 75% of our own budget goes to current, not capital, but recurrent budget. Recurrent means just running government. It means just to buy those things that will continue to keep people in government, not investing in what can be for the future. We have to reverse it. It's the first fundamental problem. If you are budgeting 75% of every money that you have into just running government, there's nothing much to go for education.
It's
the first of the problems.
Thank you. Chief Mamodu, would you like to answer?
For me, it's not just about funding. We have broken it down in my party, the National Conscience Party, so we have to look at students. How are students surviving, whether at the primary, the secondary, or the university level? In terms of funding, I believe there is a lot of money at about $306 billion right now. That's a lot of money. But we are not sure if the money gets to what it is supposed to be meant for. So we have to deal with students, we have to deal with teachers, we have to deal with administrators. We even have to deal with the curriculum. Is it because when you talk about spending money, and you are not getting the results. When we were in school, I knew the sort of thing that we read, but today, talk to a philosophy student, he doesn't even know who Bertrand Russell is, he doesn't know who René Descartes is. So for us, we're not just going to concentrate on the infrastructure because we have to upgrade. We've decided that in the first year, we will upgrade at least 25% of all our schools. Right now, you go to schools where there are no desks, no chairs. We have to take care of that, provide the enabling environment, make sure that the teachers are retrained. Because when you have teachers who are not even better than their students, it's a problem. So we have to make sure that we look into that. Then in the area of administration, there is so much politics going on at the moment. And then the retraining for us is very key. When we were in school, we used to see inspectors come around to talk to our teachers, and when they are coming, you see everybody cleaning up, everybody's getting ready for them, but everything has collapsed. So I think it goes beyond just funding it. You must make sure that the money meant for specific things are spent on those things.
Thank you. Governor Shekarau, would you like to?
I think it's not just about funding. I think we need to bring out very practically what is happening. The issue of poor performance in our schools is a factor of several indices. You see, we have the globally accepted adage that no nation can grow higher than the quality of its educational system. And no educational system can grow higher than the quality of its teachers. And this boils down to the fact that the teacher is the central issue, is the key issue. And so long as the teacher-student ratio is not appropriately addressed, it's not just the funding or building of schools, having the students. Let me quickly give you a very practical picture. I, as a mathematics teacher, in the days that I was taught, we were just about 30, 40 per class. And the maximum at secondary school level a teacher can take is 4 classes because it is 6 periods of mathematics a week. And if you give him 4 classes, that gives him a maximum of 24. If he has a class of 40 students times 4, that gives you 160 students, which he can adequately teach, go around, interact on one-to-one, take assignments and math. What we have today on the average nationwide is 100 per class in the public schools. Some schools you have 120. If you give a mathematics teacher 4 classes of 100 students each, that is already giving you 400 students to deal with. Unless he's an angel, there's no way the teacher will give assignments to 400 students a week, collect the assignments from 400 students and mark them. This is the same thing in English, the same thing in all the other subjects. So the main issue is that no amount of training, no amount of qualified teachers, no amount of remuneration will change the situation until and unless we're able to address the issue of the teacher-students ratio.
So how do we address that?
No, how to address that? For example, I've done that practically in my state. It's not a one-year affair, it's not a two-year affair. What we have done is I decided from the first year to take a segment of certain schools. Let's say you have a school of 10 classrooms with 100 students each. If you want to reduce it to even the barest minimum of 50 per class, that will mean multiplying the number of classroom blocks in that school. If it has 10 classes, you have to build 10 more so that you break them up into 50 per class to be able to attend to them.
But wouldn't that involve more funding?
This is what I'm saying. You see, it's a colossal sum of money. We've gotten to a point whereby the population in school has overgrown, is not being matched with the teacher provision. And because of the population explosion, almost every parent will want to have his child in school and will get them admitted. We started 30 per class was the maximum. It was raised to 40, it was raised to 50. I think by mid-90s, it was officially to be 60. Today, only God knows where it is stopping.
Manubadi, would you like to say something to
that? It's interesting to hear Governor Shekarau saying those things, because the good thing is that he has been the governor in the last 8 years.
Yeah.
And Kano State has the worst record of failure. It's one of the worst in the 98% we are talking about. And you have been in charge in the last 8 years. I believe there is something more than just what you are talking about. We need to do more. We need to be serious. We need to be fair and just. We need to bring education to the doorsteps of every single child in this country. That is not what is going on. Today in Kano State, close to about 50% of those age-going children are not in schools. What have you done about it?
So when you say fair and just, are you suggesting any kind of mismanagement of funds?
It's about getting it right, about competent leaders who knows exactly what to do, doing it at the appropriate time for you to get results. Unfortunately, those who have been in charge of our affairs haven't gotten it right. We need a change.
Chief Momodu, would you like to add something to that?
Yes, what I need to add is simply that Nigeria has reached the stage where we must make use of our best material in every sphere of human endeavor. You see, if you look at under OBSA Kwesili, for example, we were able to see specifically what was wrong. They had a lot of very bright young people who came up with policies. You see, Nigeria must return to that era of thinkers. You see, we're playing politics with the lives of our children. I tell you, it is not going to be easy for all of us. If we are shouting today that we have all these crises in education, it is simply because we don't have the best hands managing things.
Now, this question
I wonder
is
whether I can be given a minute to address this very issue.
Yes, of course.
You see, the referring back to what my brother Nuhu said, if I may probably give a few statistics. When I came on board in 2003, for the secondary schools in Kano, about 240 something of them, we had less than 4,000 teachers. And between 2003 and now, I've employed more than 6,000 teachers more to provide more teachers in the schools. You see, one thing with education is that if you neglect it for 1 year, you are likely to take 5-6 times more than that period to recover from the neglect. We've had the population explosion all over. He's already talking of a large population, large number of children that are already out of school, and we'll be encouraging them to come in. It's not just about admitting them. What are you doing to match? It's not just building the school and admitting the children. If the teacher is not there, you're only building up a refugee camp. You're going to have the children, and indiscipline will be the whole thing in that school. So what we've been doing is to make sure the teacher provision is there. And to provide one teacher is not a one-year affair. You have to invest into the teacher training program. We've been employing them. Before I came on board, there was a six-year embargo on employment. So most of the schools had no teachers, and therefore, you're going to have poor results for a very long time. The result of what we have done now, employing 6,000 teachers, will be seen probably after some period of time, because it's not a 1-2 year input.
Thank you. We're going to have to move on to the next question. This is from Kenneth Kadiri, a Nigerian who lives in Liberia. And Kenneth Kadiri says, I am 24, graduated in 2009 from the University of Jos. However, I have not observed the National Youth Service Program because I don't see any relevance in the program, especially based on the stories I heard from my parents concerning the ideals of the program. My question is, won't it be better for young Nigerians to have volunteer experience outside Nigeria instead of using the National Youth Service Corps as a tool for placing the children of the rich in top government agencies? So I think this is fundamentally a question that's challenging the National Youth Service Program. So if you became president, is it a program that you would keep as it is? Would you change it? Would you abolish it? Shall we start from Chief Momodu?
Yes. I think the NYC program was designed for a specific purpose, but over the years, like the rots in the system, just went down. I believe we must keep it. You see, it provided me, for example, an opportunity to visit Bauchi for the first time in 1982.
But there are many people who are now sent to Bauchi who change it.
No. In my own case, I studied Yoruba, and I was rejected and sent back to Oyo State. So my case was special. So I didn't have to beg or to use what they call long leg. You see, what will we do, I've told you, is that for as long as you have your best brains running things, they are everywhere in Nigeria, we will be able to enforce. It's enforcement. It's when people break the law and they know nothing will happen, they will break it with impunity. He was a police officer.
So specifically, what would you do? You would keep it
so
as
what
it
will
is.
We do is to make sure that just like we came here now, we were asked to pick some papers for us to sit down. And it was enforced, so there was nothing like a governor coming in first or a police officer coming in second. We did things properly, and that's what Nigeria must do.
Okay. Well, let me badge in.
Oh, I'm in Nigeria coming first. Well, I
believe that the NYSC scheme worked. It helped to unify this country. We have made a lot out of the system, and we can improve it. We can address those difficulties and challenges. But I look at it as one of the success stories.
Mm-hmm. Presently, today.
Come again?
Do you still think of it as a success story today?
Oh yes, certainly. It's still the only avenue through which, you know, our own young men and young women could move around and opportunity for them to work in some other part of the country that they are not from. it's still, that is the principal thing. And the majority of the students are still doing that. There are a few like Dele